canopies where a lot of the action is in a system like this. And there's multiple levels of leaves generally. This time of year, actually, a lot, some leaves have been dropping. So there's, in the middle of summer, it actually looks more, even more lush. But the more leaves you have on a piece of property, the more photosynthesis you have, the more biomass production, the more overall biological productivity. And the more layers of vegetation, you also have more habitat. And the older the trees and the different kinds of litter and large woody debris, stumps, snags, the more of these attributes the system get, the richer the biological diversity can get. So a system that starts at a ground level and, you know, just a annual garden has very low biological diversity, but a system like this is going to have a lot more bird species, insect species, spider species, microorganisms, arthropods, all kinds of things living in the soil. So we are creating more niches for different life forms to have their life. And the total overall, you add up all those life forms, it adds up to the total biological productivity of a site. So diversity of function, diversity of structure, diversity of ages, diversity of canopies, diversity of leaf types, conifers, deciduous, all those things add up to a richer and healthier ecosystem because there's more checks and balances, less likelihood of diseases, insect problems, etc. So these systems can be really productive, really stable. They change over time. They do need management for the best production. And you need to have people there to harvest it because there's a lot of stuff to harvest. Ah, what a great morning. Here we are at the Whispering Pine Homestead, North Central Washington near Lake Chelan. And so we're going today we're going to look at a variety of the different kinds of plantings on this old homestead. Actually, I guess we couldn't call it an old homestead. It's been established here for about 30 years. And so everything here other than the native plants has been planted in the last 30 years. Here we have a hardy kiwi fruit. Most people know kiwi fruit as those fuzzy things, real acid, egg-shaped plants that are fruits that you find in the supermarket. But this kind here grows great in our climate, grows great all around the Northwest. And it has small fruit, but there's no hair, and they're really sweet and sugary. This is just a prime fruiting plant. A lot more people should grow it. And so this one has quite a bit of production this year. A beautiful fruit, and definitely an edible ornamental. A Hosui Asian pear, one of the, you know, just a companion plant here for the hardy kiwi. And this year has a very light crop, or it's already been picked.
The Phyllostachys bamboo. There's hardly any bamboo growing in eastern Washington. But this plant here has been going for like 25 years. It's just every now and then a test winter will kill it to the ground, or it gets so thick we just cut it all back down, but it regrows splendidly. So bamboo in the desert, really nice filbert. They got so tall they were cut down to the ground and have resprouted, but and look, here's the remnant of the real hairy kiwi fruit. See here, this beautiful fuzzy leaf plant. This is the true kiwi fruit, Actinidia deliciosa. And just beautiful. I don't know if you can catch the red hairs on these shoots, but it's a gorgeous plant. And right at the moment it was cut back, but it used to grow well up into this tree here. So lots of Actinidia on the place. Actinidia calomicta, another of the hardy kiwi fruit. Looks like there's just one small fruit here.
still remaining on the bush. It makes a male, needs a male and a female. You know, you can see it's just a small little oblong green fruit here. Mm-hmm. But another tasty nibble. Mmm. Look at this.
And then, of course, oh, look at the gorgeous colors here. This is high bush cranberry, Viburnum trilobum, also known as cramp bark. This is for people with cramping problems. And it makes a real tart jelly. It needs a lot of sugar. But look at the color on this. So wonderful edible ornamental as well. Called Xanthoceras sorbifolia, or yellowhorn tree, another really rare tree you hardly ever see. It's in the Sapindaceae family, which has a lot of subtropical fruits. So it's the furthest north representative of its whole family. And it produces these big seed capsules, three-part seed capsules. This is just an old one here, all falling apart. And inside are all these seeds, which if you crack them open, have like a miniature macadamia nut. So this is a nut tree for the temperate zone, probably a zone 5, zone 6 tree. And you can grow these little tiny, delicious little nuts.
This tree here is the Evodia tree from eastern China. Again, a very rare tree in cultivation. And it's also called the BB tree because it is incredibly attractive to honeybees. So here we are in pretty much October 1st, and it's just still blooming like crazy. So this is a very good late honey flow tree for honeybees, anybody who has honeybees going. So it's just a beautiful looking tree. And look at this trunk here. This was planted here 27 years ago, more than a one hugger. So it's probably grown faster in diameter than any other tree on the property. So beautiful musculature, reminds me of beech, the way the growth pattern is here. But this tree is very successfully adapted to this location.
Take a look at this American persimmon, Diospyros americana. Diospyros is actually ebony. So this is the American ebony tree. Heavy, heavy dark wood. They used to use it for certain, ball bearings almost, certain implements back around the old turn of the several centuries ago. It was one of the heaviest, densest woods of all the woods in North America. And this here is just full of fruit right now, this American persimmon. They're not big, but they get very tasty, and it gives really big yields. They go really straight. It's an understory tree in the eastern central Midwest U.S. And of course, it's famous for possum.
Here's an American persimmon that was just grafted this spring. It was a male, and so we had too many males, not enough females. So you can see, good-sized tree, and side bark grafts here. And then these shoots, this is all this year's growth. But look at the size of the leaves here, there's juvenile leaves. So this is a really good take. And we've got several of these grafted over, and so we're going to increase our persimmons over time.
Well, this is a bit of a, you might say, an agroforestry garden here, in that there's trees mixed in with the gardening. We have peach trees in here, a number of peach trees, apricot trees, honey locust, mountain ash, the persimmons. So a variety of tree species, almost all of them edible or nitrogen fixing, with a wide ground cover. And the ground cover here, there's a lot of strawberries, there's various beds of things, but you can see it's a real hodgepodge. It isn't like rows or beds of neat things. You actually have a
dozens even of different plants all growing together here. And this is a relatively, we might say, a semi-wild ground cover here. It's managed to some extent, but it certainly has, there's very little what we would call noxious weeds. They're almost all, everything in here is flowers or herbs or medicinals and some vegetables. But it's quite diverse, and it's just sort of developing on its own. It's not, we haven't decided where everything's going to go. We let nature help do some of the selecting. Here's some blueberry bushes, and you can see great fall color, wonderful edible ornamental, protected by bird netting during the ripening season because the birds think that we're a giant bird feeder, which the place is, but some things are off limits, like these blueberries. Thornless blackberries. Over on the coast, everybody considers blackberries a big problem, but here, we don't have enough of them, so we brought in these thornless blackberries. Very, very prolific. Huge yields. So here's the blackberry pies of winter here. And here we are in eastern Washington in the apple zone. Chelan County is one of the biggest apple producers in the state. And so, of course, we have lots of apples on the place, probably 12, 15 kinds of apples. And so always a lot of apples in our root cellar. Apple juice, apple pies, apple fritters. Cressus arizonica, all the way from Arizona. Drought tolerant, tough tree. We planted this one right here because we used to sled down the hill, and in the winter, several times we'd clip this riser here and have a geyser in the middle of winter, which is always a hassle. So we planted this tree so that we wouldn't hit the pipe sticking out of the ground here. But it's grown lovely. I mean, this is just barely get my arms around it now. So lovely, and I can also use the foliage for a smudge. And it's also used medicinally, so. Wow. One of our Asian pears, a really great yield this year. Another edible pear ornament is a pretty unusual tree. This is sea buckthorn or sea berry, Hippophae rhamnoides. We've got one up here that's fruiting, hopefully. This is looks like this would be a male. And so we got some females recently. So this is nitrogen fixing from Central Asia with a medicinal fruit. We've got Siberian pea shrub here, Carragana arborescens. There's an oak tree. We can see one of the white oak trees in back of us here. And what we have here is there's a fence line back here, a deer fence. And all along the deer fence has been planted trees and shrubs. So it's a hedgerow, windbreak, habitat fixture. And the old fence posts have rotted out over the years, but the tree limbs have gone through the fence, so the fence still stands. So you can put in your deer fence, plant your trees, and never have to replace the post. It becomes a self-supporting fence after a while. So plant your new posts as you put in the old ones, because they will rot out eventually.